So this is the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, thank you. Good morning to everybody. And I'm very thankful to you that you are giving me half an hour of your time. We have half an hour starting right now, right? Starting right now. Half an hour of your time or your life to listen to what I have to say. So I'm flattered. But I have a big challenge because in half an hour, I have to cover here what my lifetime work has been, which is 40 years of addressing exactly this question. I left academia in a tenure position in university in order to test my methodologies. How do you actually transform organizations? How do you do it in reality? And I devoted the last 40 years working with companies all over the world doing exactly that. My specialty is two places: getting people to the next stage of the life cycle, from the founders, from entrepreneurial management to professional management, and the rejuvenating bureaucracy. So I have a challenge in half an hour to summarize 40 years of lifetime and 10 books that I've written about the subject. So let's see how we do that. And all I'm going to do, obviously, because of the time shortage, is just give you the bottom line, the highlights. And if you want to know more, then you have to look at my books. What did I find out? I found out that, well, you will agree with me that I'm saying nothing new if I say that there is change. I mean, change has been, specialists in Europe experience so much change. What, oh boy, this is the wrong pen. There's a lot of change going on. But you know something, it's nothing new. Change has been going on since the Big Bang. I mean, change is going all the time. But what I discovered, however, is, and you know that too, I mean, it's not something which is original. Anytime there are change, there are problems. Why? Because there is a new event, and now you have to decide what to do. But what I discovered, however, is that this change, all change, follows a life cycle. Everything is born, ages, grows, and dies. Not only trees, not only people, also stars. If you're an astronomer, you will say, this is a very old star. This is a very young star. If you're studying rocks, you will say, this rock is a young rock. And this rock is, you know, very old rock. I personally, by the way, touched the oldest rock on Earth, which is in Greenland, the oldest rock. So there is a, everything has life cycle. Not only products, the life cycle of a product, and not only life cycle of civilization, which Toynbee has written about, but also organizations have life cycle. They grow, they born, grow, age, and die. And what they discovered is that the problems are predictable. They're predictable because at every stage of the life cycle, you have typical problems for that stage of the life cycle. You will always have problems. One of the utopians' thoughts are, if I only solve these problems, I'll have no more problems. Just the opposite. You solve these problems, it gives birth to new problems, so you will always have problems. But the trick here is to realize that not all problems are abnormal. At every stage of the life cycle, you have normal problems, you might have abnormal problems, and you might have fatal problems that will kill the organization. And the trick is to know the difference. And what they discovered is the following thing. What is normal at one stage of the life cycle, if it does not get treated, becomes abnormal at the next stage of the life cycle and becomes fatal at the next stage of the life cycle. If I tell you that somebody drinks a lot of milk, wets his pants, and cries all night long, how old is this person? Well, you will say probably a baby. Say, yes, if it's a baby, it's normal. But if I tell you if it's a dean of school and 45 years old, we have a problem, right? So whether a problem is normal or abnormal, problem here, it goes and comes, it goes and comes. Are you okay now? Please. Yeah, it kind of fades and comes and goes. So whether something is normal or abnormal depends where you're in the life cycle. So what I'm going to do now very fast, present to you what is normal and abnormal at the growing stages of the life cycle. I will not deal with the stages of the life cycle because of the subject we have here. The first stage in the life cycle is called courtship. That is a stage when you're thinking to start something, like thinking to start a business school, thinking to start something new. It's not born yet. You're just thinking about it. That's why I call it courtship. What is characteristic of a courtship? Lots of noise, a lot of excitement, lot of uha, muha, buha, you know, it's like a plane before taking off. Lots of noise. I mean, why are you making so much noise? You're still on the ground. What all this tremendous noise? Why do we fall in love before we get married? Why all this? What's going on here? There is something going on, and I would like to share it with you, and that's the bottom, that's one of the highlights. When a founder of an organization, and many of you are founders of your organizations, thinks about starting an organization and is very, very excited, falling in love with, and you tell everybody how great it's going to be, how important it is, how we need to do it, and you are selling all the time. By the way, honestly, whom are you selling the most? Yourself. Why are you doing it? What's going on here? What's going on here? It's subconscious. It's subconscious. And here's what's subconscious. Subconscious, you know that when the organization is born, and what does it mean born? That's why the little Z in the chart. When the organization is born, what does it mean it's born? When risk is taken. When is the organization born? When a risk is taken. As long as there is no risk, it's all talk. And then when the risk is taken, oops, the baby is born. Now we have to rock, feed it, change it, take care of it, you know. Now we don't sleep all night long. When the organization is born, risk is born, what do you need? Commitment. So what happens in the courtship stage, you are building commitment, you are building commitment, you are building commitment, and then you plunge into and start swimming. Now hear me well. The higher is the risk you're going to take, the higher has to be the commitment you have to the company. Too many people launch big ships in shallow waters. They want to start something very big, but their commitment is very shallow. Does not work. But what is the problem down the road? Like in a marriage, you're very, very much in love, but after 7 years, everybody experiences what's called the 7-year itch. You're not so sure anymore, you know? What happened to the commitment? Slowly. Same thing in a company. What happens to many people that start a company, they build a company, build it big, 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 and at a certain point, pardon me for this expression, but one of the founders of a company told me, Dr. Adizes, do you know when do you stop making love to a gorilla? I said, I don't know. He says, not what you want, when the gorilla wants. You know, what you when you started, you had a little hairy little monkey. You were playing with, you were having a lot of fun, you were committed to, and all at once this bloody little monkey became a gorilla. Now you don't know who is doing to whom, you know? I mean, who is controlling whom? Now you want to, you say, enough, I had enough, I want to leave, you know? And now the gorilla says, no, you stay here. Difficult time. So what happens to the commitment? The commitment starts to evaporate. And the challenge is, if you don't transfer the commitment to the rest of the organization, when the founder dies, what happens? The company dies. I have seen that more than once. That's called the founder's trap. In the business world, it's called the founder's trap. When the founder dies, the company eventually disappears. In the business world, it's also called the family trap. It takes about 3 generations for the family to lose the business on average. So here we have a challenge. What gives birth to an organization is commitment. But that commitment is not permanent. Over time, and as the organization becomes more and more complex and bigger and bigger and bigger, the commitment starts kind of getting old, you know, starting asking yourself, how much longer? I think I'm in a trap. I created my own trap and I cannot leave now. When the organization is born, your commitment is tested. How much are you really committed? Now is a time, it's called an infant organization. You have to work hard. You have to feed it, change it, rock it. I mean, it is endless amount of trouble. And in your world, it is, where do I get the students? Where do I get the money? Where do I get the faculty? How do I get the quality? How do I get the endless. That's why your commitment is being tested. And the next stage of after infancy is called go-go stage. What happens at the go-go stage? Go-go stage, it's like a baby. He finally starts sleeping all night long. Finally, it's peaceful, calms down. What happens after that? The baby opens its eyes and everything is interesting. Everything is interesting. Then they turn around and they start crawling and they go all over the house and you have to do what's called baby-proof the house because they open drawers, jump from the sofa head first down. Same thing in an organization. After the infancy comes the go-go stage, and the organization, founder of the company, becomes relatively arrogant. Wow, we did it. We can do anything. Now we can do new programs, new countries, new this. Ah! That's the arrogant stage of the life cycle of the organization. And invariably, the organization will get into trouble. Invariably, I would like you to know that. In the business world, invariably. And also, I watched it for political systems, also the same thing for a country. Because what happens at that stage, and I would like you to hear me loud because we are approaching the subject of the of a presentation to you, to make the transition. Founders of organizations, by and large, look at the outside. They're externally oriented. They're client oriented. They're building a business for the clients. You see, they're building an organization to satisfy needs that they identified in the marketplace that they believe with passion, and that's why passion is extremely important to building commitment. They believe with passion that they can satisfy that need. Boy, I can do it. I know the world needs me. In my lectures, I usually say it is like a mother that needs to give birth, period. I need to have a child. You know, I have that call. The same thing with the founder. I have a call. I need to do it. I need to do it. It's not profit usually. Profit is a result of. I need to do something, to build something. And they're externally oriented. And now in the go-go stage, they start expanding like this. This is called the space syndrome. Expanding on the margins, but collapsing at the core. Because building an organization is like building a high-rise. You build a high-rise with three floors, but the foundations are only for three floors. But there is demand for more real estate. There is not enough real estate. You're getting all excited. So what do? Build the fourth floor, the fifth floor, the sixth floor, the seventh floor, but the foundations are only three floors. What is going to happen? You tell me. It's going to crack. But usually founders of companies do not like to work on foundations. That's boring. There is no money there, you know. It's not exciting. The excitement is strategic alliances, new business, money, programs, you know. That's exciting. To turn around and to look at the foundations and to look at budgets, discipline, people, reward systems, job descriptions, this is boring. I mean, that is, you know, I had one founder of a company says, Dr. Adizes, I will hire you as a consultant, but one condition, don't start making boxes, you know, just don't, they hate a box. Can you imagine a founder in a box? I mean, no boxes for me, you know, free. I want to build the world. And that's how they get into trouble. I've not worked with, one university in my life, but in the business world, predictably, they get into trouble. And let me tell you what the trouble is. Has many manifestations, different organizations, different manifestations, but they're a common denominator. In the business world, they get in trouble with the franchisees, or they get sued, or they, you know, they didn't pay attention to the details and the government sues them. I mean, I've seen it with Enron, with WorldCom, with all these organizations. They just don't pay attention to the details. You know, they build a big empire, but the foundations are weak. They get into trouble. Another trouble that happens is that the organization turns against them. This is the next stage, you see. When the company gets into beginning of trouble, the next stage is called adolescence. If you look at children, they're called babies, infants, children, and when they're here, they're called teenagers are monsters. I mean, oh my God, teenagers are a trouble. But what is the common denominator there? See, they want now to be adults and have the authority of an adult, but with the responsibility of a child, and it doesn't work. Same thing in an organization. At this stage, this transition, that the subject of my meeting here with you, this transition is a very complicated transition. That's the stage when there begins to be a hate-love relationship between the organization and the founder. Hate-love. Like with adolescent children. The adolescent children love you and hate you at the same time. And you too, by the way. You love them and hate them at the same time. There are moments you love them, it's my baby, I created this baby, and there are moments you say, if I can burn this organization down, I will do it, I had it up to here. What's going on? You crash. And the organization loves the founder because they said, you know, he or she is the leader, he's bringing us the money, they have the connections, they are the one that are the heart of the organization, but they are also the source of all our trouble. All the time, new things, changes, things, you know, we cannot ever catch up, you know, calm down. And the founder has the same love-hate relationship. I love this baby, but I'm in a trap. They just take all my energy away, all this trouble. I want to build an empire and I'm stuck with this nonsense down here. What should I do with that? That's the problem of the transition. And if you don't solve the transition correctly at the right time, very often what happens is really tragic. I want you to know that. I've seen it in many, many organizations. They fire the founder. They fire him. The board of directors says, you know what? He or she was a genius. Now he is an unguided missile, uncontrollable, is the source of all our trouble. Enough is enough. Thank you very much. Go home. And that person, I've seen it, it is really tragic, goes home and says, I devoted my life, I don't know my family, I don't know my children. Everything I had is this company, and now, I mean, it's really tragic. They don't know what to do with themselves because the company was their life. They actually die. I've seen some people get cancer and die. And by the way, what happens to the company? Here's something very interesting. Now the board goes opposite direction. So we had enough excitement, you know, done. Now what we need, somebody who is stable, organized, systematic, thorough, dependable, you know, and usually they pick up a financial guy, you know, to manage the whole place. By the way, it's good for a while. Because we have a saying in Hebrew at least, enemies go and come. No, sorry. Friends go and come, enemies accumulate, you know? So same thing here, entrepreneurs go and come, bureaucrats accumulate. So they appoint usually a bureaucrat to take over from the founder because they had enough excitement for a lifetime. Now they want something, you know, stable. That person for a while will stabilize the company. He will. He will get it all organized. He will fire any exciting people. Because he wants order, he wants systematization, he wants budgets, he wants predictability, don't give him any hard time. And the place becomes stable, which is good for a while. We need to corrective action, right, after all the excitement. But eventually what happens over time, because of change, that stability becomes dysfunctional. And I've seen companies start to die. Because the heart, which was the entrepreneur, the founder, is gone. All right, my friends, so what should you do? Now I should tell you what to do, right? I forgot what time I started, how much time I have. I always forget that. 10 more minutes? Okay. Now here is what you should do, okay? Look. From here disease. Here the company is born when the risk is born. Here the company is getting separated from the founder. That's why the birth is the second birth. They are kicking hard. They want to separate. Like the children want to leave the house and to be independent. They want to be themselves now. That's why the struggle. Second birth. From here to here, the founder is the company. Normal. If you want to know what to do, you go talk to the founder. Founder tells you what to do. It's very centralized decision making. Normal. Not separated. So what to do? How to make that separation much easier? Here it is what you should see. From here, it's normal to have the organization structured around people. You look at people through the organization. No, you look at the organization through people. So we are growing. We need new program. We need a new coordinator. We need a new dean. We need a new director. So basically, who is available? You're available. Oh, I found somebody. So let's see what you can do for us. Everything is organized around people. The organization is around people. But that makes it very centralized. It's everything around the founder. You see, it becomes our organization structure is custom made around the personality and the preferences and the people that the founder found, which goes with the jokes, you will remember it. I use jokes to manifest what I'm lecturing about, but people remember the jokes or remember the material. A guy went to buy himself a custom-made suit. And as you know, custom-made suits, you always have measurements, you know, 1-2 measurements prior to delivery. So he goes to the measurement, and he sees that the sleeve is too long. He says, the sleeve is too long. And the tailor says, no problem, do like this, and it will be okay. What about this sleeve? Do like this, you'll be okay. What about the shoulder? Well, do like this, you'll be okay. So the guy puts his suit on, and he walks down the street. And two ladies pass by, and one says to the other, look at this poor guy. And the other lady says, yes, but the suit fits him. The whole organization is structured around the personality, you see. Now try to bring a professional management into this suit. No chance. No chance. No chance. You will get into trouble or you will get the organization into trouble. There's always a conflict between the here are the typical mistakes. Let me go over the mistakes. I can't manage anymore. It's too big. I need a professional manager to help me. So let me hire a new COO, Chief Operating Officer, or a president, and I will be the CEO, whatever it is. And you bring the person in. Can't fit. And now you know what happens? Fighting. Fighting. The other guy tries to organize the place, tries to systematize the place, and you're bringing all the trouble. And now he tries to organize, you make the mess. And what's happening? Bingo. You start fighting with each other. It's very difficult. And actually develops almost a hate relationship. And then depends who is in power. If the founder is still in power, he says, this guy is detail-oriented, is not like me. Do you hear the word? Is not like me. He's too, you know, he's stupid. It's too stupid, you know. What I really need is somebody like me, exciting, energetic, you know. What the hell am I doing with this guy? Fire him. Bring the next guy, energetic. Now they start fighting. You have two entrepreneurs. Everybody has his own thought. Fire this guy. And they go through succession of people and says, I cannot find the person I need. I cannot find the person you need. Classical mistake number one. Or if the guy you hire is very politically astute, which happens often, develop a relationship with the board, and they start feeding the board with information how terrible you are, and how you are a source of all the conflicts, and you are creating too much trouble. You were good to start the company. Yeah, you are really, you deserve all the credit, but right now, you are not an asset anymore. You see, you started as a genius, and now you become an unguided missile. You know, nobody knows what to do with you. Now we, and then the board says, you know what, maybe you're right, until the company gets into trouble because of Gogo. This is the conflict that occurred at that time. Another mistake that we do, you know, hire somebody like yourself doesn't work. Hire somebody who's different doesn't work. Another mistake that some of them do, I call it the seagull syndrome, seagull. If you have a boat, you probably don't like seagulls. Seagulls are those birds that fly, crap on your boat, and disappear. Same thing with the founder, you know, he built a big thing, now he hates all this mess in the company. So he starts traveling, going away. I go away, and then reappears, and then he gets all upset. And he gets all the company in trouble, leaves again, comes again, leaves again, and everybody is paralyzed. Oh my God, he comes now, what does he want now? All right, let's see what he comes there. You know, the whole company is back in, out, you know. These are all the mistakes. What should you do? Should you do? The organization from here to here is structured around people. You look at people to structure the organization. Wrong. It was good to start with, because when you started, you don't have a structure. There are no job descriptions, you know, whatever needs to be done, you do. You know, this is a partisan time, we don't have this, we are all guerrilla fighters. Now that the organization is some size and some budgets and, you know, it exists and it's running, it's not a baby anymore, you need to do the following transition. Look at my hands. Instead of the organization structured around people, you have to structure people around the organization. The organization is born. What I'm really saying when I do this work with organizations is forget the people. How do we forget the people? Forget the people too early. The joke I use is say, you know, the right sequence is very important. To sneeze and to wipe your nose is the right sequence. Too many people, first they wipe their nose, then they sneeze, and then they're surprised and know that they look ridiculous. Well, my dear friend, the sequence is wrong. Let's hire people, I need people. But the structure is not there, you know? So what happens? Doesn't work. You have even more problem. And then you have a turnover of people. Stop people, don't look at people. Ask yourself, what does the organization want? The organization is being born. When I work with the company, often you know what they do? Everybody has a name tag in front of them. I take another chair, add it to the table, and I put the name of the organization. So I know what you want, I know what you want, I know what you want. What does the organization want? It has a name too. Well, how do we know what the organization wants? Well, first thing what we have to do is mission. What do we really, what is this organization all about? Where is it going? You have to re-engineer the company. You know, like we were talking to Danice about Siemens. Siemens is a Central European, it's not anymore. You have Canada here, you have Singapore here. So what is Siemens all about? You're at that stage, by the way. What's your mission? What's your purpose? I know where you started. Give us the best, keep the rest. Good. Now, what now? I mean, this is a different organization now. So you have to redefine the mission. First thing is redefine the mission. Where are we going? What are we trying to do? Who are we? And we are not what we used to be. I would like you to know the following thing. There are certain languages, now the truth of the matter is I forgot which. They don't have present tense. And if you think about it philosophically, there is no present tense. It's either a second ago, part of the past, or the beginning of the future. There is no present. It either ended or is starting. So many people talk about who we are looking at the past. Don't do that. Who we are as we go into the future, like they say, today is the first day of the rest of your life. Forget the past, it's dead. Where are we going? Who are we as looking into the future? Don't drive forward looking at the rear mirror. Too many people drive forward looking in the rear mirror. It doesn't work. Look in the future, look in the past. Driving in the future, look in the past. Past is dead. Where are we going? What is this organization all about? What are we trying to be? Are we a business school or are we a management school? Are we a regional or are we global or are we national? Are we specific to a certain industry? What the hell are we? Who are we? What are we trying to do? Who we are? Remember, the word are is present tense, but it's not continuation of the past. It's the beginning of the future. After you do that and you visualize, the process of visioning is very important. Where are we going to be 10 years from now? Then you say, okay, in order to get there, what kind of a structure do we need? What do we need? Then you start doing the structure. But structure without people. Don't put any names, because you get into names, you're in trouble. And I'm telling you that because for the following reason. There is an expression in Hebrew from the book of the wisdom of the Jewish people that says, very interesting sentence, no prisoner frees himself of his own chains. No prisoner frees himself of his own chains. And it's also autobiographical for me. I'm in the founder's trap myself. I built my institute, devoted 40 years of my life, and I'm experiencing all the troubles I'm describing to you. And I have freed in my life, I don't know, 40 years, probably, I don't know, maybe, I don't know, 500 companies, from startups all the way to the largest company on earth. I can do it with my eyes closed. One company I cannot free from the founder's trap. And it's very, I mean, it kills me. I believe I'm the best in the world in what they do, and I cannot do my own goddamn organization. You know why? Because you cannot see the picture when you're in the picture. I'm aware of it, you see, because when you start to try to make this transition, what the organization is, you start thinking about the people. Yes, however, on the other hand, another guy can do it because he don't know the people. The people are not, you know, but you're attached to the people, you hire the people. You cannot make it. It's very difficult to make it. One of the good things of being an alliance and being a network, you can help each other. But remember, you cannot help yourself. It's too difficult to do it. I have not succeeded. And I watch many, many organizations that try and cannot. And usually what happens in the business world, the private equity fund comes in, buys it out, fires the founder, appoints a businessman, end of the story, transition finished. Somebody from the outside does it because they cannot do it from the inside. But that's what you need to do. You need to go and look at the mission, then what is the right structure, and then you hire the people. Now, how do you do that mission? Let me recommend to you something to do. And I will then stop for some questions. The entrepreneurial spirit, which the founder is strong at. The founders are entrepreneurs. I've never seen a bureaucrat start an organization. You know, that's entrepreneurs do that. They have a dream. They want to do something different. They want to build something. It's an urge that they cannot help. They cannot be an employee. You try to give them a job, you know, as an employee, they cannot. They just cannot, period, end of the story. They're burned, you know, they have a burning in the stomach to do something different, build something different, make the stamp in the world. I see this, you know, when I got this idea, I was consulting to the Prime Minister of Peru, 1971. And I'm sitting on the beach in Peru one afternoon at free time. It was a winter, nobody on the beach, but somebody built a sandcastle just next to me. And I see a little kid approaching the sandcastle. I knew exactly what he's going to do. What is he going to do? Destroy it and build his own. That's what we do, guys. That's what we are. We cannot help it. It's part of being, that's why we are childish. Entrepreneurs are relatively childish. They have to do it. But that excitement, you see, that excitement is monopolized. It's monopolized. Where the problem is. And later on, when you try to make the transition, they don't have your vision. That's everything is around you. Now, in a business world, in a large organization, entrepreneurship is institutionalized. When you get here, when you get from entrepreneurship to professional management, the organization is professionalized. They have institutionalized entrepreneurship. It's not individualized. You don't care who the president of IBM is, do you? Because they have departments. Marketing, who think about the market and marketing research and strategic planning. There's a department. There's the engineering department, new product development. It's not only in the founder. Then you have finance, not accounting, finance. Where do we get the money? How do we raise money? Human resources development, not human resources administration, development. It's in the organization. It's not monopolized by a person. Here it's all monopolized by a person. As a matter of fact, the founder monopolizes it almost on purpose so they don't lose control. They decide what the program should be. They bring the money in. They hire the people. They develop the people. They look at new product development. Everything is they alone. And when they die, the company dies. Why? Because their development of new ideas and the control of all the entrepreneurial activity is monopolized. So what you need to do before you start doing the mission, here is, I'll give you an advice and I will end up my presentation, the bottom line ideas I'm giving you. For small companies, and most of you I think are small companies, you cannot afford to have a vice president for finance and vice president for marketing and vice president for human resources development and vice president for product development. I mean, maybe you can have one of them, but all the four of them and top-notch people, it's too expensive. So what the hell do I do? It requires some requires some discipline, but here's what you should do, if you can do it. You take your calendar, my friends, and you block a day a month, starting in the afternoon, because people have to work in the morning. Start 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, something like that. And go outside of the company, go to some hotel room somewhere. Take your top people. It could be, I don't know, top people, 4, 5, 6 of them. What are your top people? And here are the rules, guys, here are the rules. You schedule it for the same day every month. Not, oh, let's decide when we meet next time. That will not happen because you're going to start traveling. No, it has to be like Christmas. We know every year when Christmas is. You cannot decide, well, let's decide when we are going to have Christmas. Christmas is Christmas. So you say, and in my company I did it, I said, if anybody is not here, you better bring a piece of paper from the doctor that you're sick or I'll kill you. Everybody, and I said, if I'm not here, I commit, I will pay you $10,000 to the company for some charity if I'm not here. So I'm, because I'm the biggest problem, I'm always traveling, I always disappear. I say, I'm committing. And all of you are committed. You have to be here, period. Next, don't have an agenda. Do not have an agenda. Because the moment you have an agenda, it becomes a committee meeting, an executive committee meeting, and we start the fighting and the discussion and review of decisions and follow up and... No. This is not a P, if you know my methodology. It's not a P meeting. It's an E meeting, entrepreneurship meeting. What do? You don't have an agenda. You should have a topic. Agenda means we are going to discuss this. We are going to decide. You are not allowed to decide anything in that meeting. No decisions taken. None. Because the moment you have decisions, it starts becoming tension, discussion. No decisions, remember, please. You have a topic. The first month is going to be, my language, marketing. Where are we going? What's happening? What's the competition doing? We just talk. Guys, when you were courting, you were talking a lot. What happens when the company is born? We have no time to talk. That's what happens in many marriages. When you're courting, before you're married, we have time to talk and we are in love and we share. Then we get married. Nobody has time for nobody. And everybody says, a marriage destroys a wonderful courtship. That's what happened. You must have time. Devote time. By the way, don't find time. Take time. That's what I'm telling you. Block a day a month. Block it. Just block it. One afternoon or one evening. I don't care. 3 hours, 4 hours. Sit down there. Take all the ranks. Nobody is a president. Nobody. We just talk. Talk. I call dream sessions. By the way, why call it dream sessions? Because if you go to psychiatrists, And you say that you cannot, you don't dream, you don't remember your dreams. You have a problem, you know that. You need to dream. A healthy person needs to dream. Because dreams relieve the fear of the past and act the future, the hopes of the future. You need that. Same thing in organization. It's a dream that builds an organization. It's a reality that kills an organization. You need to have periodic dreaming. And who is dreaming now? Not you alone, the whole management team. Where are we going? What are the possibilities, et cetera, et cetera. Next month, I call it engineering, technology. What programs do we need? How are we going to do it? What kind of a new technology are we going to use? No decisions to be taken, because the moment you decide, you wake up. Please, don't decide. Just talk. 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 Third month, finance, the third entrepreneurial component. Where is the money going to come from? Where can we get the money from? Fourth month, human resources. Where do we get the people? What kind of people do we need? Are we getting the right people? Fifth month, start all over again. Now, why is that good? If you die, the dream does not die. The people continue, you see? It's like in a good family, the parents die, but the children have a ritual of getting together for New Year's Eve, getting together for Thanksgiving, getting together periodically, and there is a ritual. And they remember the parents. When their rituals are not around, when the parents die, the children don't see each other anymore. You have to create that environment. You have to create that ritual. Then it's easier to do what is a mission, what is the structure, what kind of people do we need, and it's easier for them to fit in, because others absorb them easier. And then you see in the structure, I will finish, that's what I did for Tom Moynihan of Domino Pizza. I built it from $2 million to $4 billion company, and it was free. The guy was free, he's now building Catholic missions around the world. Totally free, sold his company for $4 billion. How did we do that? First, when you do the structure, you delegate all the P and A functions. What does it mean? For the new world, it will be the organizing and operation carrying out the different programs, okay? And accounting and facilities and all this stuff that you don't like anyway. And you have under you marketing, finance, product development, and human resources development. So that is taken away. Then you start slowly delegating one by one, more and more. Keep the one that you are dedicated to. And you see, I'm doing it one piece at a time. Then you can appoint somebody to be dean development and dean operations. Dean development is what? Get the money, new programs, new people, new technologies. You operate it. And I am chairman of the board. I open doors and I direct. You see what? You're free. But you don't do it at once. You do it in steps. And let me finalize. Dream sessions, mission, structure, hire the people, delegate first the administrative and operational functions, then slowly, one at a time, the entrepreneurial functions, then integrate the entrepreneurial functions under one person, and then that is the person who's going to be your successor. You see what's happening? You're building it up, and then you're free. I thank you very much.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Dr. Adizes. And I already received some hints, you know, from the participants, but let Dr. Adizes to talk more and more. But I think that's exactly what the idea was behind, just to give the introduction and to provoke our thinking. And we would give a chance to Dr. Adizes to make conclusions and and make summaries at the end, you know, when we would discuss ourselves, when he would be able to hear, you know, more our challenges and what kind of the issues we've been facing. So thank you very much. And we still have, I think, a few minutes for a few questions, if somebody has, or comments.
Whatever I see, people have no questions. They either understood everything or nothing. So I don't know which one of them.
I think personally, listening to you, yes, I've been feeling, you know, what you are talking about my life story. So I think everybody been thinking this.
Thank you. What person who built this building, this organization, and prepared some successor, what this person, even to be young, should do next? Any such experience?
Right. You see, I have a vulgar analogy. What happens when an old guy starts looking for a young woman? So you have to look for something new, something new, exciting. I belong now to an organization called L3, which is exactly this kind of people who build organizations, made a lot of money, but they are too old to start something, a new company, but they're too young to retire. So they're saying, now what do I do with my life? Well, you find something else, not a new company. You find something else that still you want to contribute. You know what? Usually it's to teach, to mentor others, to build others, and to contribute to the society. Because then you realize that not, okay, let me give you an analogy. I must do that. Give me 2 minutes. I had a client, I won't tell you in which country because I don't want to embarrass him. And I helped him, working with him, go from $250 million capitalization to $3.5 billion in capitalization. So one day I asked him, what are you doing? What are you building here? You know, he started with 100 stores and now he has 1,800 stores and banks and television stations and telephone companies. I mean, what? He says, well, I can buy a bigger airplane. Okay, so bought the biggest airplane you can have, private plane, with a sleeping bedding room, etc. And I think, what's next? So, well, now I want to have a biggest yacht. So he bought himself the biggest yacht, 182 feet with jacuzzi and swimming pool and you name it. Says, what's next? He says, now I want to have a big villa on the beach, and he bought the presidential compound. I don't know whether he bribed the government or not, but he had the president's compound, is his now, on the beach. So what's next? Oh, now I want to have a farm on the mountains. What's next? And then I realize it reminds me of a woman. No matter how much clothes she has, she needs to buy more clothes and more clothes and more shoes and more clothes and more jewelry. How much clothes do you need? I mean, you don't even wear half of it. How much do you need? And then I realize, why is she behaving like that? Because she's empty here. You're empty here. Because when you're empty in your soul, you try to fill it with things. Same thing with this executive. He's trying to fill his soul. So what you need to do, my friend, is work on your soul. Because when your soul is full, everything else is irrelevant. And I think what one of the things that worries me, how would you like that there is a program for women, how to buy more shoes and more clothes, and how to measure their success by how many shoes and clothes they have? I'm sorry, my friends, but that's what you do. All these MBA programs, you're teaching them how to measure themselves by materialistic measurements. Market share, profit, return on investment, assets, you know, more clothes, more shoes, more of this. And we are destroying the world. One of the things that we have to start putting in the programs is some spiritual growth. So when we are as a founder, we build the biggest closet with the most clothes we can have. And now, what do I do? I'm empty. Our spiritual need needs to be fed. And that's what we don't do. When you have the spiritual side, no problem. You leave one thing, there is something else. I mean, you contribute to the society. You maybe volunteer to go to Africa and teach people how to manage their little companies and survive. I mean, there is so much to do. Go like Carter and build houses for poor people. There is a lot what to do if you have a soul. And that's what we are losing in our work. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any more questions? Okay, so I think we still will have a chance to ask a lot of questions and discuss with Dr. Adizes. So I think we should give once more a big hand for this first.